As the Insider exclusive investigative news team travels across America producing the Justice in America Network TV series, we invite you to join us as we uncover real stories about the issues that promote justice and fairness for injured people, safeguards victims' rights, and the opportunity to help guide the hands of justice, especially when people's lives have been destroyed, families ruined, dreams lost, or widespread societal change and reform are needed. These true stories about real ordinary people, their real lives, always up close and personal, and always unfiltered stories of unimaginable pain, suffering, and great wrongs, but also of courage and faith and the dauntlessness of the human spirit. These stories are also about the trial lawyers who helped these ordinary people navigate a very complex legal system to get justice as they faced extreme life-altering adversities, and how the government and big business with their million-dollar PR campaigns are slowly eroding our rights to seek justice and making an end run around the civil justice system. Our TV stories show relief and vindication for shattered lives and seemingly lost souls. The compassion, warmth, love, and determination of the human spirit found within these shows are neither imagined nor contrived. They are truly personal crusades and telling journeys of what it means to seek justice in the American courtroom. In this Insider exclusive network TV special, Justice in America, The Truths and Myths of Tort Reform, we visit with Scott Bercer, founding partner of Bercer and Fisher PA. As he takes us inside today's legal system, examining lawyers' strategies, clients' thoughts, and in vivid detail, showing you the often heartbreaking stories of these clients, dramatically demonstrating what motivates trial lawyers to fight for their clients' causes. Some of these same trial lawyers have been in the crosshairs of attacks by so-called tort reform advocates for the past 30 years. These attacks are not new. Now, a lot of you have heard and read about tort reform, but really don't understand how or what it really means, or how it affects us negatively every time we walk into the courtroom. So in this special Network TV Insider exclusive documentary, Justice in America, The Truths and Myths of Tort Reform, we will show you how tort reform is making justice more and more difficult for the average American. And we're not going to do it by words or fancy language, but by inviting you along to meet our guests and their lawyers in small towns and big cities filmed across America, who've had the unfortunate bad luck to be severely injured or victimized by big businesses, the government, or law enforcement. These victims could be you or me one day, and if you are so unlucky, you will quickly find out that justice in America is a hard-won battle where very few companies and individuals do the right thing. And you need trial lawyers who wage a battle with their own financial resources to get their clients justice. But before we get started, just for the record, let's define what the heck tort reform means in simple language. Tort is a legal term describing the system of compensation used by the courts to assign remedies, awards, and damages for harm done by one party to another, be it to their person, property, or other protected interest. Tort law defines what constitutes a legal injury and establishes liability. It's the civil court's answer to criminal law. Tort reform, then, is the political term for the controversial issue of reducing tort litigation, awards, damages, and/or compensation. Now, tort reform isn't one single idea or law. Instead, it's a group of ideas and laws designed to change the way our civil justice system works. While each tort reform law is different, they all share one or more of the following goals: to make it more difficult for injured people to file a lawsuit, to make it more difficult for injured people to obtain a jury trial, and to put limits on the amount of money injured people receive in a lawsuit. Keep in mind that throughout history, our civil justice system has kept Americans safe by allowing them a fair chance to receive justice when they are injured by the negligence of others, even when it means taking on the most powerful corporations. When corporations and their CEOs act irresponsibly by cutting corners on safety, producing unsafe products, polluting our environment, or swindling their employees and shareholders, the last resort to hold them accountable is in our courts. The legal system provides justice to those injured by deliberate misconduct and deters future misconduct by holding wrongdoers accountable. Here's just a quick review of a few Justice in America Network TV show segments of these real case stories of ordinary people, their real lives, and their trial lawyers who've helped these ordinary folks navigate a very complex legal system to get justice as they faced extreme life-altering adversities. Real cases that promote justice and fairness for injured people, safeguards victims' rights and the opportunity to help guide the hands of justice, especially when people's lives have been destroyed, families ruined, dreams lost, or widespread societal change and reform are needed, and how the government and big business are slowly eroding our rights to seek justice, making an end run around the civil justice system and calling it tort reform.
Throwing it into the stands, leaving only enough time, 3 seconds, for Clay Rush to possibly kick the game winner. Rush has made field goals of 20 and 26 yards, missed from 41. This one will be from 20 yards to win the Arena Bowl. On its way, it is good.
When I think about football when I was playing, I like the challenges that it present itself. You had to be physically fit. You had to be mentally fit. What's unique about arena football? I miss the fans. It's a close-knit group. We consider us as a family. I've had over 30 procedures done with the head and neck. I've been on 90 different medications. I don't know what it's like not to have a headache.
For many of the nearly 50,000 9/11 first responders, the wounds of the Twin Tower attacks are far from healing. These rescue workers continue to struggle with respiratory illness, depression, and post-traumatic stress disorder, and many of them may be at increased risk for developing a number of cancers. Because they and their fellow rescue workers were picking through rubble littered with asbestos, mercury, crushed fluorescent light bulbs, and other known toxins, and they were outfitted with only their normal uniform to protect them from potential contaminants. When hundreds of victims and their families were left struggling with impending health problems and emotional instabilities after the World Trade Center attacks, the Uniformed Firefighters Association of Greater New York selected one law firm, Sullivan, Papain, Block, McGrath, and Canavo, their friends and trusted legal advisors for the past 20 years, to come to their rescue. Because sometimes even first responders need to be saved.
I was promised a better life, far away from my home.
I used to have a family.
Now, I must pay for my family's debts.
I sleep with many men every day. They make me
kill for a war.
Work many long hours.
Trapped
beaten,
scared, locked in the dark.
With no way out.
I want to go home.
I want my freedom.
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 The last thing that we as Americans would remotely suspect is that the greatest engineering firm in the world, so named because they were able to build a Panama Canal when no one else could, the greatest engineering firm in the world caused the flooding of this city, not Hurricane Katrina, the United States Army Corps of Engineers.
And because of one negligent moment, it has become a painful and needless tragedy.
The state of Louisiana's medical malpractice laws are full of traps, and how the healthcare and insurance industries are far more protected than anywhere else. In Sharon Boxey's case, you will see how her doctors malpositioned her head and neck during surgery that substantially reduced blood flow through the carotid arteries to her brain, causing massive brain damage, which went undetected during surgery and rendered her a total quadriplegic.
So far in 34 years, no one has come close to having a Supreme Court decision finding that the cap or the act was unconstitutional.
We are going to show right now a day in the life of Sharon Boxey and what these doctors did to her. And you're quite familiar with this video that we have on the screen right now. Tell us a little bit about her daily activities.
Well, her daily activities are markedly reduced. Her sister and her family have been incredibly supportive, caring for her and doing the physical therapy and the other steps that are necessary to keep her alive and functioning as well as she possibly could. But basically in the course of a day, because of her limitations, she can do virtually nothing other than watch TV, talk with people who come over, maybe read a little bit. But even read, I mean, she can't turn a page. She has no movement in her hands or arms or legs.
Don mentioned to me, Sharon, that one of the reasons that you have so much drive and fortitude is you want to show others that the laws in the state of Louisiana aren't the best laws in the world concerning medical malpractice cases, right?
That is great.
July 26, 2003, at approximately 3:45 in the afternoon, Christopher Allison and his family were driving back to Pocatello, Idaho from their vacation in Washington. Suddenly and unexpectedly, their vehicle was struck by another driver from the rear, jackknifing their camper and overturning their Ford Expedition, crushing and killing Christopher and injuring the rest of the Allison family. Today, the Insider Exclusive will show you how the Allison's lawyers, Robert Krause and Emily Rankin of the Spence Law Firm, took on Ford Motor Company and successfully sued them for the defective product design of the door latch and component system and other defects, and got justice for the Allison family.
My name's Jeffrey Scott Hornoff, and I'm a police officer. I was convicted of first-degree murder and sentenced to life in prison. Every step of the judicial system failed me and my family. And if not for the guilt and remorse of the true killer, I'd still be in prison.
She died. I killed her.
Why would you not want to ensure that California stops putting innocent people in prison? It's a very good question.
I was locked up when I was 20 years old, just turned 20 years old. I'm 42 now, so I've been in a little over 22 years.
It was hard for my father to explain to me. I got convicted of raping somebody, but daddy didn't do it. So it was like, How you not do it, Eddie? You've been in here for all these years now.
Everything in life is wonderful, and then one day, somebody comes up and tells a lie on you, and you end up in jail. What's different is he knows fair doesn't exist.
When they told me rape, robbery, possession of instrument of crime, gun, conspiracy, all these, I'm like, oh my God, you know, this is almost like 100 years in jail for something you didn't do, and I'm really scared.
I was in shock because I got found guilty.
I looked him right in the face, and I said, you and I both know I didn't kill anyone. And he couldn't look me in the eye.
He sentenced me to all that time, and I didn't know what to expect in prison. You know, I expected to be beaten, be raped. I expected to die in prison.
The government has failed the exonerated.
It's finally over. It's been 19 years.
What now?
Go home.
Dr. William J. Irwin failed to comply with the appropriate standard of care for an OBGYN in the year 2007. And as a result, Rebecca Gatti, a newborn baby, suffered severe brain damage, which is lifelong and irreversible. Those brutally frank words were how the Louisiana Medical Review Board explained to Ryan and Susan Gatti, the parents of their new baby girl, Rebecca, why Rebecca had suffered irreversible brain damage due to the incompetence of Dr. Irwin, and now will require round-the-clock care for the rest of her life with no chance whatsoever for improvement. Today, the Insider Exclusive will take you behind the headlines of this real-life couple, Ryan and Susan Gatti, who entrusted their child's health and welfare to this grossly incompetent doctor. Following is a TV commercial for American Family Insurance.
Since the dawn of time, people have needed people. The personal connection, the shoulder to lean on, that is our role. To deliver more than just a policy on a piece of paper, to deliver peace of mind. Because we are family. American Family. And like family, we grow stronger each day with the constant promise to always be fair, helpful, and caring. Doing whatever we can to make things easier. Striving to keep our promises. This is what we do for our clients. We get to know them like family. Because that's who we are. American Family Insurance.
But today, the Insider Exclusive presents a true, really tragic story, one that American Family Insurance doesn't want you to know. One hot Missouri summer day, Galen Ritchie's sister, Brenda, called her insurance company, American Family, and her agent, Catherine Philip Leitz, telling her that a 1,400-pound tree limb, nearly half the tree, had fallen on Brenda's house. She called three times that week, and on three separate occasions, American Family refused to pay to have this 1,400-pound limb removed.
Hello?
If you don't care about people, you couldn't do this job. Sounds real good, doesn't it? Only problem is, Anthem Blue Cross really doesn't mean what they say. Ask Bob Daringer, widow of Esther Daringer. 49-year-old Esther beat breast cancer until it metastasized to her brain. Ohio State University physician Dr. Herbert Newton, her physician, had successfully treated cancer like Esther's through intra-arterial chemotherapy. Her husband's health insurer, Anthem Blue Cross, paid for 3 of the 12 scheduled treatments. Bob and Esther first learned that the 4th treatment was being denied the day before it was given. The insurance company had approved the first 3 of the 12 treatments, but then refused further payment, declaring the procedure experimental. Cigarette smoking is the leading cause of preventable death in the United States. It causes serious illness among an estimated 8.6 million persons. It costs $167 billion in annual health-related losses, and it kills approximately 438,000 people each year. Worldwide, smoking kills nearly 5 million people annually.
Stand here today with dedicated colleagues from within the Department of Justice as well as beyond it to announce a historic settlement with Pfizer Incorporated. In a combination civil and criminal settlement, Pfizer has agreed to pay $2.3 billion, the largest health care fraud settlement in the history of the Department of Justice.
You now know that exposure to asbestos products caused this.
Yes.
Not only in the Navy, but also working as a custodian at the school.
Yes.
You're on national TV now. What do you have to say to the manufacturers that created these products?
Well, they knew years ago, and they should have started much earlier in the process of eliminating the asbestos from all their products. Mm-hmm.
They chose not to, you know that.
They chose not to. Most of the major companies, some that were litigated against, filed bankruptcy and then turned around and regrouped, and they were doing the exact same thing.
They're going strong.
Using the same products.
Yeah, they have a total disregard for human life, don't
mm-hmm.
they?
They do.
Thank you.
quit being a correctional officer and I chose that field because I wanted to make a positive impact on inmates. I view my prognosis as good. I keep responding to treatment, and I was just talking to my sister yesterday because there's times where you get down and you think, oh, you know, you just want to give up.
Cannot operate with one hand.
Dr. Anthony Sterling is an orthopedic surgeon who can no longer take care of his patients. He's been disabled ever since 1998 when he had surgery to remove a bone spur pressing on his spinal cord. The surgery did not turn out well. The worst thing that could happen to a surgeon happened to Dr. Sterling. During the surgery, he suffered a terrible injury that rendered his left arm completely paralyzed, and it remains paralyzed to this day, trapped in an ugly brace. So the man who routinely performed about 500 surgeries a year and expected to continue helping patients for another 15 years can no longer enter an operating room.
Across the U.S., people are rising up against fracking for natural gas. A deadly threat to our homes and our lives is looming on the horizon. It is a new technique of gas oil extraction. It is known by various names. For example, the oil and gas industry says it isn't new. The industry says it's safe. But the industry is lying. The vertical gas wells are a completely different technology. The new technique of deep horizontal fracking destroys drinking water supplies, pollutes our air and our environments, and will continue to do so for possibly hundreds of years as the well casings inevitably fail and disposal sites inevitably leak. In this insider-exclusive investigative TV series new documentary, Fracking, Dangerous Contamination, Bob and Lisa Parr's story. Our news team found that in any area where fracking operations have happened, the local people have been outraged by the catastrophic damage to land, water supplies, air quality, animal and human health. Local economies have been destroyed, property values have fallen drastically, up to 90%. And one of those areas is in Wise County, Texas, where the Barnett Shale is located. This is where we begin our story with Bob and Lisa Parr, at their ranch and with their lawyer, Brad Gildy of the Gildy Law Firm.
Question. You were here in July, and you said that you were you commended Dodd-Frank for providing a blueprint to get rid of too big to fail. We've now understood this problem for nearly 5 years. So when are we going to get rid of too big to fail?
Well, some of the, you know, as we've been discussing, you know, some of these rules take time to develop. The Orderly Liquidation Authority, I think we made a lot of progress on that. We've got the living wills. I think we're moving in the right direction. If additional steps are needed, then Congress obviously can discuss those, but we do have a plan, and I think it's moving in the right direction.
Any idea about when we're going to arrive in the right direction?
It's going to take, it's not a 0-1 kind of thing. It's over time.
concern that you have raised is one that I frankly share, and I'm not talking about HSBC now, because that maybe that not be appropriate, but I am concerned that the size of some of these institutions becomes so large that it does become difficult for us to prosecute them when we are hit with indications that if you do prosecute, if you do bring a criminal charge, it will have a negative impact on the national economy, perhaps even the world economy. And I think that is a function of the fact that some of these institutions have become too large.
Tell me a little bit about the last few times you've taken the biggest financial institutions on Wall Street all the way to a trial. Anybody? I appreciate that you say you don't have to bring them to trial. My question is, when did you bring them to trial?
We have not had to do it as a practical matter to achieve our supervisory goals.
Can you identify when you last took the Wall Street banks to trial?
I will have to get back to you with the specific information.
These are just a few of the real Americans who have dealt with our legal system that is gradually eroding in favor of big business and the government because of tort reform legislation. And this is why we all need to protect a legal system that is designed to protect us and not one that protects corporate business or the government over the common everyday American. Scott Bursar, our featured guest, represents everyday people across the U.S., primarily in the fields of telecommunications, pharmaceuticals, and dietary supplements. Since 2008, Scott has tried numerous class actions and won multi-million dollar verdicts and settlements. These and other class actions make the marketplace safer and better for consumers and investors because corporations have an economic incentive to treat them fairly. Class action lawsuits have uncovered years of corrupt practices in the tobacco industry, contamination of groundwater that caused cancer, fraudulent pricing strategies, and misleading advertising by drug companies, and predatory payday lending practices. When companies or institutions cheat, harm, or discriminate against large numbers of people, class actions are often the only way to hold them accountable and win justice. Under the guise of so-called tort reform, corporate wrongdoers are trying to limit or outright ban class actions nationwide. Class action lawsuits are a powerful legal device. Properly used, they are often the only way to achieve justice. Abused, they can impose enormous injustice and support corporate wrongdoers' attempts to eliminate them entirely. Power unchecked is power abuse, but many of those with power have few restraints, and they keep devising new ways to block ordinary people's access to the courts. Across the country, corporate wrongdoers are amending their contracts to ban individual and class action litigation. They are also working to expand federal preemption, mandatory arbitration, and court secrecy to preclude many suits and bury the rest. The ability of Americans to join together in a class action is essential in pursuing corporate accountability. And Scott Bursar and his firm, Bursar & Fisher, are dedicated to ensuring this. Further limits on class actions will only give corporations a green light to rip off consumers and workers. Scott Bursar has earned the highest respect from citizens and lawyers alike as one of the best trial lawyers in New York, in California, in Florida, and across the nation. He understands that corporate abuses are some of the most serious, enduring, and divisive social, legal, and ethical violations in the United States. The problem is nationwide, and its nature is institutionalized. And because of that, he is driven to fight for people who have been harmed by the willful or negligent actions of others. His goals? Not only to get justice for his clients, but to make sure that everyone is treated with equal respect and dignity as guaranteed under the Constitution of the United States. Scott has built a substantial reputation by consistently winning cases other law firms have turned down. His amazing courtroom skills and headline-grabbing success rate continue to provide his clients with the results they need and the results they deserve. This is the Insider Exclusive. Live from New York. Great pleasure to introduce Scott Bursar to the show. Welcome to the show, Scott.
Thank you, Steve. It's good to see you again.
Tell our audience a little bit about your specialty, your practice of law.
Well, my firm is Bursar & Fisher. We have our office in New York City, where we're sitting now. We have a second office in California, in Walnut Creek in the Bay Area.
We've primarily been involved in representing customers of phone companies,
purchasers of dietary supplements, purchasers of defective appliances, automobiles, variety of products.
Right. I understand that you're one of the few, if not maybe the only lawyer that has ever taken class actions, five class actions to jury trial. Is that correct?
We've done, yeah, class action cases almost never go to trial, yeah. Steve. I mean, We won all five out of the five, but I don't know another lawyer that's tried more than one of them, and that's usually the opposing counsel on the other side of my cases. It's just so rare to see a class action case go to trial. And I think that's one of the things that makes our firm unique in the field, is that we've actually run the whole race and taken a case all the way through from beginning, all the way through a trial verdict, all the way through an appeal. And we've had a great track record of success, but just having gone
a lot of the other firms in the field, where it's typically get on file and then look for every opportunity to just end the case as quickly as possible, usually at a very low bargain basement price. So we're able to take cases deeper into the litigation process. We think we get more value for class members that way.
That's one of the reasons, Steve, that I think our firm, for example, has never done a coupon settlement. You hear a lot about that in the class action field, where lawyers file the case, the lawyers make millions of dollars, the actual class members that they represent end up with a coupon or some trivial payment. You'll find if you take a look at our website, if you take a look at our track record, the cases that we've done, class members have gotten real value, real dollars in the pocket, and I think that's because of our unique commitment and our unique ability to actually take the cases deep enough into the process where you know, you put the defendant at risk and get some real dollars on the table.
Right, and they've cost your firm a lot of time, as well as a big investment on your firm's part, because, for example, the Sprint case that you initially filed in 2004?
2003, Steve.
2003.
Yeah. We're in our second decade.
10 years later. 10 years later. $300 million verdict, by the way.
Two jury trials. We've won two jury trials. We've won 18 appeals. Every single appeal we've won. And I think that's an example where our firm's invested, you know, more than $1 million out of pocket. And our colleagues in that case, we're working on that case with other firms that are millions of dollars into the case.
Yeah.
It's tremendously expensive, tremendously time-consuming. We've been working on the case for more than 10 years. We're out of pocket over $1 million, and we haven't been paid a dime. Now, we do have a $300 million jury verdict in favor of the class that we represent. We've not yet collected on it, but we're going to continue to pursue it, and I think we're getting close, Steve. We're going to get some real money back into the hands of the Sprint customers who were cheated by that company.
Dietary supplements, a wide open field, riff with a lot of scam artists, right?
Mm-hmm.
How do you find your cases there? What kind of investigative work do you do?
Well, it's hard to not find cases in the dietary supplement field, Steve, to be honest with you, because in the mid-90s, Congress passed a law called the Dietary Supplement Health Education Act. And what that law said was that it created this whole new category of products called dietary supplements. It used to be you had food or you had drugs, and food and drugs were both regulated by the FDA. Mm-hmm. What this new law, the Dietary Supplement Health Education Act, did is it created this third category of products, and it said if you're selling, you know, a vitamin type product or a diet, you don't have to have the rigorous pre-market clearance that you need for a drug. And so basically anyone can come up with their unique recipe of herbs and spices, mix right. it together with some caffeine, and start selling a product that will melt fat off your body like a blowtorch. Yeah. We have several cases like that. And so it just opened up the marketplace. And if you just walk down the aisle of any health food store, you'll see literally every product is just being marketed in a completely fraudulent way. So people come to us all the time because we've been in the business so long and had such a track record of success. You know, in the Avacor case where we did a dietary supplement that, you know, supposedly was a clinically proven way to regrow. Weight loss cases like the NutriQuest case that we did in New Jersey on the Zenadrine product. So people come to us all the time having bought these phony diet pills. They're typically a massive dose of caffeine mixed together with some herbs and spices that have never been shown to have any effect whatsoever on weight loss. Mm-hmm. The FDA has determined years ago caffeine is not a safe or effective treatment for weight loss. So you have a lot of companies who are selling what is essentially a mega dose of caffeine and marketing it as a weight loss pill. People buy that stuff, are almost always unhappy with it, and come to us and we try to vindicate their rights, and we try to do that through class action litigation. Because obviously, Steve, I mean, one person of diet pills for $40,
$30. You're not going to hire a lawyer to
filing fee in federal court's $400.
Yeah.
So there's no way you could ever bring that claim in an economically rational way, right. Let alone hire a lawyer, unless you can do it as part of a class action. Right. And that's what we do.
Are dietary supplement companies trying to, let's say, restrict the way that they can be sued right now?
It's tough for dietary supplement companies. The answer is yes, but they don't have a good means to do it. You know, there's been a lot of very restrictive decisions that have come down out of the United States Supreme Court, particularly in the field of arbitration. So companies that historically have been held to account through class actions, principally phone companies, companies that have a contractual relationship with their customers where you have to sign up, what they're doing is they're putting arbitration agreements into their click wrap or, you know, form agreements, and that has put a big crimp in the ability of customers of those types of businesses to seek justice in any court.
What are their arbitration clauses that they have in their contracts generally?
I mean, typically if you take a company like AT&T or Sprint or, you know, most phone companies, most cable companies, they will have some fine print in their user agreements or in their subscriber agreements that says that if you as a customer do business with them, you waive your right to bring any kind of claim against the company for any wrongdoing whatsoever, intentional wrongdoing, outright fraud. You cannot bring a claim in any court in the United States of America. And the only recourse that you would have is to bring a claim in a private arbitration on an individual basis where the filing fee for that arbitration would always exceed the maximum amount of the claim that you could ever bring. Right. So it's essentially a get out of jail. If whatever we want to you.
And the U.S. Supreme Court has upheld this, haven't they?
Well, we talked about this back in 2011, I think a few weeks after the Concepcion decision came down. It was AT&T versus Concepcion. Where the Supreme Court enforced AT&T's arbitration clause. For about 10 years before that decision came down, we were undefeated in challenging those clauses in court. AT&T tried to have them, a lot of other companies tried to have them, and we would always be able to persuade a court that those agreements were so unfair that they couldn't possibly be consistent with any kind of system of justice, and so they couldn't be enforced. Right. What happened in 2011 is the Supreme Court came down and said, federal law preempts all those decisions. We love arbitration. We think it's a great thing. And from now on, when AT&T or other companies bring an arbitration motion, you know, courts should enforce them more rigorously. And that certainly is. It was hot news at the time, and I was hopeful that we would be able to persuade most reasonable courts to have a reasonably limited interpretation of that decision. But I'll tell you, it's been very difficult. That Concepcion decision has, it's essentially given total immunity to whole segments of industry in the United States. Any kind of phone company now has total immunity to put whatever kind of charge they want on any customer's phone bill, whether it's valid or not. And the customer has no means to bring any claim in any court in the United States of America. You essentially, in order to get a cell phone in the United States of America, you have to waive two of your key fundamental rights under the Bill of Rights. You no longer have a right to a jury trial. Right. You no longer have a right to any trial. Yeah, I mean, it's almost like you have to give up your American citizenship in order to get a cell phone.
Yeah, you know, that obviously was argued in the case, you know, presenting that. You do no longer have the right to a jury trial. Mm-hmm. What did these nine justices in the Supreme Court, why didn't it register with them?
Well, Steve, it did register with four of them.
Yeah.
Four of them understood what was happening. Yeah. The other five, I mean, unfortunately, I think they bought hook, line. The United States Chamber of Commerce, which is arbitration is a more efficient, a private arbitration is a more efficient, more streamlined process. It's going to help people get their disputes resolved more quickly, more economically, but it really doesn't. I mean, I think the people who are actually involved in the justice system on a day-to-day basis, as opposed to looking at it from, you know, 10,000 feet above, people like me, recognize that these arbitration clauses aren't a means of shifting a dispute from court to a more efficient private forum. There are means of just preventing the claims from being brought in any form at all.
Yeah, because you mentioned the filing fee, the arbitration fees can be as much as what?
I mean, I think the American Arbitration Association, the typical filing fee is over $300. JAMS, which is another arbitration outfit, similar, a few hundred bucks. And that's before you, just filing, you're also paying conference room fees. You have to pay the arbitrator. Now you pay taxes to pay the salaries of the judges who sit on the bench at the courthouses, but you can't get their services. Now you have to pay for a private judge. So there's fees and fees and fees. And if you're in a scenario where you have to bring your claim only on an individual basis, and you have a claim for a $30, you know, charge on your phone bill, or even a $200 charge on your phone bill, you can't afford to hire me, or anyone to, you know, any lawyer to take
for
that case.
And you can't
afford to pay the filing fees, the conference room fees, the arbitrator fees, the legal fees, and it's just not worth the hassle. You know, I think it's Judge Posner, who's one of our great appeal judges, who's wrote, and I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but only a lunatic or a fanatic sues for $30.
Yeah.
And so unless you're completely irrational, you just don't bring a claim. Mm-hmm. And as I've said, you have whole segments of it.
Yeah. How do you pick cases now? How do you select the cases to utilize the class mechanism that you use?
I mean, I hate to say this, but one of the first things we do is look to see if the client might be subject to an arbitration agreement. And if they are, we almost never take the case now. And I mean, I hope we see some change in the law soon that's gonna prevent that or allow us to represent those people going forward, as we have for the past 10, 15 years. But right now, we just can't do it. So that's number one. Second thing, how do we pick the cases? You know, I don't know that we have a real recipe. I think at our firm, we have some areas that we have historically concentrated on. Telecommunications, phone bills, both wireline phones and cell phones. We've historically done a lot of dietary supplements, diet pills, weight loss, hair regrowth. We've done mislabeled appliances, defective appliances. We've done automobiles that have had problems that have affected a whole line of automobiles. So I can't, you know, there's no one recipe, there's no sort of formal screening process that we have, but it's sort of, I guess it's like pornography. I think it was Justice Potter who said, I know it when I see it. We do very extensive investigation before we decide whether to take a case and whether to file a case. And it's, you know, it's a very, you look at the unique circumstances of each case in depth before you make the decision, because it's such a huge commitment for our firm to undertake one of these cases. I mean, sure, we finance a lot of the costs out of pocket to the tune of millions of dollars and some. Mm-hmm. And we devote amount of our time and effort for years without being paid. So we try to be very, very selective.
Yeah.
We just have to.
You take a lot of cases to trial. You also settle a lot of cases. Where do you make the distinction?
Well, usually the decision to settle really isn't ours, it's the defendant's. If they're willing to come forward and put real money on the table, that's going to put real money in the hands of class members.
Yeah.
We generally will settle the case. I think the unique approach that we take is because we present a credible threat to take the case to trial and to judgment and to win a money judgment, I think we're able to get more value for class members than a lot of other firms in our field. And I'll give you an example of that, Steve. Earlier this year, we had a case against Pac Bell Telephone Company. It's the AT&T wireline subsidiary in California, where they were charging late fees on phone bills that were, if you looked at them as an interest rate, and you know, in some instances it was 50, 60, 100% interest rate on a late fee. So we challenged those late fees as being unlawful penalties under California law, usurious interest charges under California law. And we litigated that case from 2010 right up to early 2013, and we took it right to the brink of trial. And the settlement offers that the defendant made, I mean, it's, you know, I can't get into too much detail, but generally was, you know, pennies on the dollar, until we got up to the day before opening statements at the trial. And so by taking it to the day before opening statements at the trial, and by having the track record that we have, the defendant, you know, when they saw basically the whites of the eyes of the jurors, they put $38 million on the table.
Right.
And that's a settlement that we did earlier this year, $38 million settlement with Pac Bell. That's all cash. It's going to put real money in the hands of the customers who paid those late fee charges that were unlawful.
You know, one of the reasons that we did this show is because we're aware that your firm puts real money in the hands of the people that have been aggrieved. And I want to thank you very much for being on this show. We intend to have this as an educational process so people understand really that their rights are being whittled away and they don't even know it.
Thank you, Steve.
Thanks for joining us. You can get more information about our guest and the issues at insiderexclusive.com.